Pound. Jo.
Thank you. Also, thanks to OWASP for inviting me here. So I'm going to talk about leaky processors, some exciting low-level stuff. But before diving into that, I want to start with a higher-level question. Namely, what is a secure program, right? And I think a very workable, a very nice start definition is that a secure program transforms every input to the expected output, right? So we have a little black box, it transforms input to output. And in this respect, a very important, well-known result in computer security were buffer overflows, right? Where we found that if we pass invalid inputs to the program, we may trigger some unexpected behavior, produce some unexpected outputs, and basically break open this black box, right? So let's say we get some cryptographic keys or secrets out of the black box. So that's a very well-known issue, and over the past decades, we have been working on solutions for this, right? You all know this, safe languages, even formal verification, and we can prove that the black box maintains its intended behavior at all times. I think that's a very important result, and it remains important to date for real-world programs. But as a research community, we have kind of moved on. This is a solved problem, and nowadays we are looking at side channels. What do I mean here? We are studying at functionally correct programs, so programs that transform every input to the expected output. We are not going to iterate over invalid inputs anymore, and instead we're going to look at observable side effects of the computation. So we have this black box, and we're going to try to open it up by looking from the side at some observable effect. That may sound a bit vague, I realize, but I did a little Google Scholar search experiment here, and you can see that it's far from vague. So this research area on side channel attacks has been growing exponentially over the past 20 to 30 years, maybe. And what all of these attacks have in common is that when a victim and an attacker execute on the same machine, there will be some leakage, there will be some observable side effects. That's why some people say in computing, sharing is not caring. Right? So let's maybe have a look at a more concrete example of such side channel attacks. The main idea here is very simple. So we have this whole class that you may have heard of cache timing attacks, and they all abuse that modern processors are super fast, right? We're talking several gigahertz, and the memory that's attached is typically an order of magnitude slower. And that's a big problem because we need instructions and data in memory all the time. So we need to overcome that speed gap, right? And the traditional way to solve that in hardware design is to add a simple cache. So the main process is simple. Every time software accesses a memory address, it's transparently brought into the cache. So the CPU consults the memory, waits for a couple of hundred cycles, get the result back, stores it close to the CPU, knowing that most likely in the future we will need this again. So then indeed, when we use it again in the software, the CPU can reply super fast and can say, nice, I had it in my cache, I don't have to go to memory. So what we have now is a measurable timing difference, right? Cache hit, cache miss. Let's see how to abuse that as an attacker. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to walk you through a start-to-end attack known as flush reload. So we have a victim program, let's call it the sender, the green domain here, and we have an attacker program, let's call it the receiver, the red domain at the bottom. And I'm going to transmit one bit of information indirectly through the cache. So let's start with the attacker. The attacker will flush some shared variable, I call it A, from the cache. So this puts the cache in a known state, and we know that when the victim executes next, it's going to suffer a cache miss. So the victim, depending on some secret here, will access either A or B. And if it accesses A, we know it's going to suffer a cache miss. It's going to consult the memory. The memory is going to respond in a few hundred cycles. The CPU keeps it close, right? A bit later, the attacker takes over again and simply measures the amount of time it takes to reload A. In case the victim brought in A into the cache, this will be fast response from the CPU. The CPU does not have to consult the memory. In case, however, where the victim brought B into the cache, secret is zero, that is, then B is not in the cache, so the CPU has to consult the memory, wait a few hundred cycles, and reply. So this is the timing difference we're using here to transmit information from the green to the red domain. So I now gave you a very concrete example of how black boxes can be opened up to side channels. However, in the wide perspective, there's nothing really new here. Don't worry too much, the crypto people are on top of this, right? You may have heard of these solutions that take all constant time, where essentially they transform this black box model into some kind of gray box. They accept there will be some leakage, but they make sure that the code is written in such a way that the leakage never depends on the secret, right? And I would say that for a very long time, this has been the state of security, right? State-of-the-art security was all about researchers finding new side channels, crypto people patching up their libraries, enhancing their gray box model, and back to the researchers to find the next big side channel. This attacker defender race has been going on for quite some time, but in the beginning of 2018, I dare to say the whole thing changed. Namely, there was this new kind of attacks, what I call here transient execution attacks, things like Spectre, Meltdown, and Foreshadow. And they completely do away with this black box model. So what we have now is that we found suddenly that the underlying CPU itself is leaky, and that means that we don't even have to look at the application source code anymore in order to exploit these vulnerabilities. So I would say that transient execution attacks are a big game changer. And what do I mean here? I'm going to introduce some new rules for the game, so bear with me for a moment. And where it all comes down to, what it all boils down to, is that all of these vulnerabilities exploit some kind of discrepancy. So there is kind of a mismatch where programmers used to think about programs very sequentially. That's not how hardware works. So let me illustrate that with a simple example. We have this little house here. Say you want to calculate, compute the area, right? You as a programmer typically would say, let's start by computing the area of the triangle, then we compute the area of the square, we add both things up, we're good. So I wrote a little program to do exactly that. Well, what is the discrepancy here? The processor is built for performance, and the processor, when it sees this code, will try to be clever. And it will say, when I'm actually computing the area of this triangle, I can already look ahead in time, at the same time, in parallel, compute the area of this little square. Then, when I stop with the triangle, I add up the result of the square, which is made available simultaneously, and I'm done a lot faster. So that seems like a super cool performance optimization, and it is, in essence, what makes current processors super fast, that they do this massive parallelism all the time by looking ahead in the future. There's also kind of a subtle note here, namely, it's merely a performance optimization. That means that when something goes wrong, for instance, when computing the area of this triangle, could be an overflow exception, let's say, then the processor also needs to roll back whatever it did for the square. So what we have, kind of, is a situation where we try to do things ahead of time. If they work out, that's great. If not, no problem, we discard the results and we move on. So that's where strange things can start to happen. And what do I mean here? Well, from a high level, we kind of have a situation where we have two walls in the processor. We have what I call the normal world in black, which is the world that the programmer writes his programs in. This is the world where things happen sequentially, and where things always make sense and everything is deterministic. There is, however, also some kind of hidden world, a shadow world. I call it the transient world here. And this is the world where the CPU is doing things ahead of time, and it's trying to predict what will be the outcome. If things are good, it adds them up to the real world. If things turn out to be wrong, no worries. They are discarded and computed again in the normal world. So that's why I call these operations transient. They're kind of held in between being committed or failed until it becomes clear whether they were correct. And talking about these two worlds is basically what went wrong. Over the past decades, CPU designers have been relying a little bit too much on these two worlds being completely separate. And they relied on that this shadow world, this transient world, is all about optimization and needs to be made super fast. And since things are never committed into the real world when they're wrong, CPU designers allowed some strange things to happen there. And what do I mean with strange things? There's basically two classes of strange things that they allow to happen. One is that in this transient world, exceptions can be arbitrarily delayed. The second is that in the basically that the shadow world, the transient world, can make predictions about the control flow of the real world. So it can try to predict where the real world is going. Now, I think the key finding of 2018 is that all of a sudden researchers found out that these two worlds are not that separate after all. So we found that using side channels, we can transmit secrets from the transient world into the real world. And that's when the whole thing collapses, because it turns out that both these optimizations can be abused. So we have attacks like Meltdown and Foreshadow, which exploit delayed exception handling. And basically, these are severe processor-level bugs that will be fixed in future processors, but for now, completely bypass protection on current CPUs. On the other hand, exploiting this branch prediction machinery, we have Spectre. And Spectre, you may have heard of, especially if you're into web development. Spectre is much more a software issue, and it's going to keep us busy for the next years, if not decades. But this is not an easy processor fix. Spectre is essentially, I would say, the micro-architectural equivalent of things like buffer overflows, return-oriented programming. So it's going to definitely keep us busy. So in this talk, I will focus mainly on Meltdown and Foreshadow, so the hardware issues, let's say. And I'm going to walk you through both of these. If there is some time left, I can say something on Spectre, maybe during the questions. So let's start with Meltdown. So Meltdown is a rather elegant attack, I would say. It's only three lines of code. But don't worry if you don't understand the code for now. There's also pictures. So let's just have a look at the pictures. This guy here is the first line of code. And it's basically a break-in, right? So you're going to access a piece of memory that you're not allowed to access. You're going to dereference a pointer pointing, let's say, to kernel memory. And as you all know, the CPU will not allow to do that. However, the problem is that before it raises an exception blocking that access, we have this transient world coming up. And again, here the analogy is that after you do the break-in, immediately some kind of guard shows up to kick you out. But before actually being kicked out, the burglar still has some time to have a look around in the building. And that's what's happening with both Meltdown and Foreshadow. So what's happening here with this yellow code is some kind of clever trick. And it's going to use a side channel to transmit information from the building, right, from the transient world into the real world. How do we do that? Well, intuitively, we consider an Oracle array, so just an array in memory. And then depending on some secret, so the secret that we just referenced, we're going to either load a location high up in this array or a location low. So let's say for now, if the secret is 1, we load this guy. If the secret is 0, we load this guy into the cache, right? A bit later, the processor catches up and says, oh, you are not allowed to access this, so it kicks you out of the building. But by then, the damage has already been done. And what do I mean here? Well, in the exception handler, the attacker can simply reload these Oracle slots. So, and if the secret was 1, it's going to be the high slot. If the secret was low, it's going to be this low slot, which has a lower access time. So we're going to implement our cache timing attack in the receiver end here. And if we measure a lower access time, we know that the secret has been brought into the cache by the victim, right? So we have a situation here where we use the cache to transmit information from the transient world where strange things happen and we can compute on secrets to the real world where order is supposed to be taking place. Once researchers realized this, Intel had a big problem, right? Because the only fix for this essentially is new processors. Intel cannot fix this bug simply by a microcode update. The only real valid strategy to stop this bug in the hardware is to ship with a new processor. So it was clear that something needed to be done for all these millions of devices out there today. And that's where operating system programmers kicked in. So they were asked to make some kind of ugly workaround for this major processor bug. The solution they came up with is basically some kind of address space separation. So technically what happens is that the user and kernel space are separated into two virtual address spaces. That's a technical explanation. Maybe I want to give you some intuition here as well. Namely that the defense named kernel page table isolation tries to put secrets out of reach for the attacker. Much like what we do for a little kid. When we want to place secrets, let's say cookies, candies out of reach, we put them in a cookie jar and place it high on a shelf where it's not reachable by the attacker. That's what's happening with meltdown defenses. And that was also supposed to be the end of it, right? We had meltdown, it was a huge processor bug, but luckily there was some kind of solution. So that's where this thing called Foreshadow kicks in. And Foreshadow has a rather complicated backstory. It all started... Yes? Yes. Which one? Shoot.
This only separates, say you have multiple user programs, right?
Mm-hmm.
They might be able to still affect each other or read memory from each
other. So this other space separation is on top of classical process isolation. So what we already have for decades is process isolation, where each stakeholder, each process lives in its own address space. However, to make that efficient, x86 processors, Intel processors, come with some kind of privilege bit in the page table, which says you have one address space for each process, and part of that address space is green, is for the user, and part of that is orange, is for the kernel. Basically, what meltdown means is this bit is broken. This alleged protection by the processor simply doesn't work. So what has to be done is to separate each program into two kind of virtual views on the program. So this thing is repeated for all the processes on your computer, and that's why the meltdown defenses come with such a performance impact. I was saying something about Foreshadow. So I would say it has a rather complicated backstory, but it all started the day after New Year's. So we emailed Intel, we said to them, guys, we found a rather major bug in your Enclave technology. And a few days later, Meltdown and Spectre became public. We engaged with Intel in a very lengthy responsible disclosure process. And in the meantime, we saw reports like this, which reports that inside Intel processors, there is some kind of super secure fortress, which remains protected and completely secure against Meltdown. We know this when seeing this, we knew this was not true. So after over half a year, last August, we were very happy to come forward with our findings. And you can see that some news websites picked it up and wrote that Intel's most secure element is blown into pieces. So what are they talking about? Well, need to give you some context here first. Namely, this most secure element that Intel proposed is motivated by this kind of observation. And what you see here is that over the past decades, software systems have become increasingly complex. And it's a very nice graph. You can see, for instance, here that the amount of software in a modern operating system almost exceeds the amount of information in the genome of a mouse. And I think that's rather impressive and rather worrisome, since we use these operating systems every day. And we are very used to rely on them, to trust them. To put it in another way, what the situation we have today is kind of like this, where we have been building layers on layers of trusted software. And in the end, we end up with millions of lines of code that are trusted to run a simple Hello World application. That's the situation that Intel started from, and they wanted to overcome this by building security directly into the processor. So what we have here is that inside the processor, there is some primitives, some encryption primitives and attestation primitives that allow to run a very small portion of super secure code in some sort of vault. They call it enclaves, where which is basically a region of encrypted memory where the encryption key never leaves the CPU. So that means that all of the underlying software, including privileged operating system and hypervisors, remain untrusted. They still need to be there for availability, but we don't have to trust them for the security guarantees of our application. So that looks like a super nice picture, but you may have seen that there is still one green box left here, right? The CPU. This only holds if your CPU is trustworthy. And basically what we did with Foreshadow is we showed that since the CPU has some subtle bug, we can exploit that as an unprivileged user and go on and steal secrets from these super secure enclaves. And this is another instance that shows that once your CPU is untrustworthy, once your underlying foundation is compromised, the whole thing collapses, right? So that's the big picture. What's the more technical explanation of the attack? Foreshadow is essentially a three-phase attack. And you can see in the last phase, we simply execute plain vanilla meltdown. But before that, we have these two additional phases where we do some trickery. So what we do essentially is to unmap the secret, which forces a physical address to be sent into the cache. More intuitively, what's happening here is that Foreshadow can read the secrets that were placed out of reach by the meltdown defense. So what we can do with Foreshadow is we can steal these candies from the cookie jar placed high on the shelf. Okay? Let's zoom in a bit more on the technical level again. So what you need here is some background on caching. So I already introduced you to the concept of caching. What's actually happening as well is the concept of address translation. So every time when you in the software dereference a memory location, what's actually happening is that this virtual address is going through this yellow box to be translated into a physical address. Okay, and that's all documented behavior, and that's all what we call the architectural view. It corresponds to this normal world that I described earlier. What's also happening in this blue box here is the micro architecture, what I called the transient world, the shadow world earlier, is doing some things in parallel as well. So what's actually happening is that your physical address is sent to the cache, which decides whether it has the location already in the cache, whether you have a cache hit, or whether the location needs to be fetched from the slow memory, whether you have a cache miss. So that's kind of what's happening on the high level. What we did with Foreshadow is we exploited this box. So we say that by provoking a page fault, you can early out the address translation process. So this corresponds to the observation that not every physical memory address is mapped. So what we do is we provoke a page fault, which implies that this physical address is non-existent, right? And you should never be able to compute on that. This is the equivalent of having some secret. At the application level, at the processor level, that means that this thing's fault. What we actually found is that this normal flow also triggers some strange behavior in the transient world, since it turns out that this physical address, although it doesn't exist, is still sent to the cache. And if the cache finds something at that physical address, it will happily forward it to the out-of-order execution, which allows us to do the tricks we use for meltdown and encode that secret into the cache. So from a high level, what we have here is an arbitrary read into the L1 data cache. So we can pass any physical, unsanitized physical address here, and it will be outputted here. And that's a major problem because the L1 data cache is shared among all protection domains on the processor. So L1 data cache is shared operating system, hypervisor, even system management mode, enclaves. So basically, all kinds of CPU protection can be broken if you can read from the L1 data cache. So that's what's happening here. To put it in another way, the enclave attack, the SGX attack, basically early outs this address translation process before the hardware machinery for enclaves had a chance to sanitize the output. And if you take this reasoning, you will also better understand what's happening with virtual machines, Because as you all know, on modern Intel processors with hardware support for virtualization, we don't have one level of address translation, but we actually have two levels, where every address from a virtual machine is normally intercepted by the hypervisor, the virtual machine monitor, to be translated into a real physical address. What's happening with our early out mechanism here is that we can send a physical address from the guest that was unsanitized by the hypervisor into the cache. So this means that we can completely break virtual machine isolation. That's what Intel calls L1 terminal fault, what we call foreshadow next generation. So after we discovered the SGX attack, Intel researchers generalized the attack towards virtual machines. Okay, so again, clear instance that something needed to be done. And just as with Meltdown, we're actually exploiting fundamentally the same vulnerability inside the processor. So we have a three-phase attack, and if we neutralize any of these phases, the attack can be blocked, right? And as you will see, the final solution for foreshadow is actually a combination of multiple of those phases. But in future processors, luckily, foreshadow as well as Meltdown will be patched, as Intel promised. So you can start expecting these processors according to the Intel CEO next year. For now, something needs to be done again for all the legacy devices out there. And they went back to the operating system developers, asked for another dirty hack. You can see, for instance, here what Ubuntu has a nice write-up on what needed to be done for this L1 terminal fault, this foreshadow attacks. Basically, it comes down to clearing the physical address bits in an unmapped page table entry and taking some additional care when doing that. More interestingly, even, is that this time also patches at a hypervisor level were needed. And here it turned out that the software guys couldn't do it on their own, so they needed help from the hardware guys. And we kind of have a hardware-software co-design, where Intel released microcode patches, updates to their processors, that allow to flush the L1 data cache whenever either an enclave is exited or a virtual machine is exited. And you can already see this is, again, big performance impact. Every time you switch from one virtual machine to another, you have to clear the entire cache. That's the only secure option. As kind of a side note, I did a little experiment here on my own laptop, which is fully patched. And you can see that modern Linux systems have this kind of /CPU/vulnerabilities directory. So it's kind of extensible. They already anticipate that there's going to be more. There's a whole directory allocated. And if you look at the Meltdown defense, you see it's just a one-word thing. Page table isolation is relatively simple. However, if you look at the L1 terminal fault, the foreshadow defense, you can see there's this whole very hard-to-parse line. And this also shows that as these attacks get more involved, get more complex, the defenses grow more complex accordingly. So I think, as you can see from the vulnerabilities directory, this is not the end of it. And we may have to end up with a whole array of mitigations in modern operating systems. So with the technical story being set, what I want to do in the remainder of the time is to look a bit into the domino effects, the ramifications that the vulnerability like foreshadow can bring. And what do I mean here? Well, you have seen very consistently that Intel always highlighted some good news in their reporting. They said that these vulnerabilities are super hard to exploit, and that to date there has been no real-world evidence that they have been abused in the wild. And I think to a certain degree I agree. These are sophisticated attacks, and they definitely raise the bar for the attacker. And you may even say that while you don't trust, let's say, Microsoft Azure Cloud with your private data directly, you may want to trust them to not mount this super advanced class of side channel attacks and transient execution attacks to just get your data, right? So, for instance, Azure now has support for Intel SGX, these super secure enclaves. You may say, okay, these transient execution attacks are not really a big problem. The problem with that reasoning, however, is that I know of at least one machine that has been compromised. And this machine is my desktop computer at work. And as part of the foreshadow research, I extracted some private keys from Intel, from the processor, from this machine. Now, you may say that's all super nice, but it's just academic research. This machine is not part of the Azure cloud, so it's not affecting it, right? It's merely showing the possibility. Well, that's not entirely the case. So to help you understand that better, I need to very briefly introduce the concept of attestation. Attestation basically is the process that a remote verifier uses over an untrusted network to attest, to get some guarantee that the enclave it's talking to, the protected piece of software, is actually running on a genuine Intel processor and not, let's say, in a simulator. And the way that works is this remote stakeholder, the developer, let's say, is going to ask a simple question. It's going to ask, can you keep a secret? And it expects an answer, yes, but not just yes. It expects an answer, yes, with a little proof that shows that the answer yes was generated by a genuine Intel processor. So as you can see, the way to do that is to put a key in the processor and to somehow give the developer indirect access to that key. So the real-world analogy here would be that you have some kind of proof, some kind of passport, and you have kind of a border control agent. In our case, it will be Intel, which acts as a trusted third party and will verify that your passport, your proof, is actually correct. The problem with this little picture here is that people don't like border control, right? And Intel was very much aware of that when they developed this technology. They did not want to be seen as the big technology giant that is going to act as the trusted border control agent all the time and is going to come with all the privacy implications that you may expect from such a scheme. So what they did is they talked to their cryptographers who came up with this notion of Intel Enhanced Privacy ID, or EPIT in short, which is basically a group signature crypto scheme that allows, from a high level, to identify yourself as part of a group. So what is going to happen is, instead of one person showing up at the border control, there's going to be conceptually a group of millions of genuine Intel processors, and you can prove that you are one of them, but not which one exactly, right? And that's a very desirable property from a privacy perspective. You know that your piece of code is running on a genuine Intel processor, but you don't know which one exactly. The downside of that is that an attacker can also be hiding in plain sight here. So the intuition is that once you extract one private key from the group, you can impersonate signatures for the entire group, right? And that's what's happening with Foreshadow. So this guy here is a lab machine that I showed you a bit earlier, and I can use it to impersonate signatures for all Intel processors, including the ones from the Azure cloud. So that's kind of an undesirable ramification that results from something that's conceptually rather good, rather a privacy-preserving cryptographic scheme. So it turns out that once you have such a key, and the full details are in the paper, or you can come talk to me afterwards, but it turns out that once you get such a private EPIT key, you can establish an active man-in-the-middle position, and you can modify and read all secrets, right, between the developer and his enclave on the remote machine. So that's rather problematic, I would say. Luckily, this has been patched as well. So let me wrap up with a quote from Ken Thompson. I think most of you will know him. He's the original designer of Unix, of course. He's also a Turing Award winner. And in his lecture, he said something which is interesting, I think, in hindsight. He writes that as the level of a program gets lower, bugs will be harder and harder to detect. And he even kind of foreshadows the possibility of a microcode bug, a processor bug, back in 1984. So that's quite, I think, revealing for the situation that we're in right now. As another kind of side note here, I want to stress that Foreshadow is just one little dot in an entirely new landscape of attacks. And as part of a very recent work, together with the people from GAS in Austria, we made kind of a survey of this entirely new landscape over the past year, where we discovered some new Spectre variants, as well as some new Meltdown variants, including the first demonstration of a Meltdown-type effect on AMD processors. So I think these are the immediate challenges for researchers right now, trying to map out this new field, trying to make sense of what's coming towards us. So what are the lessons here to wrap up? I think the short-term message should be clear. Be on top of this. Make sure you patch your systems when updates become available. I would also strongly advise, if you have security-sensitive software, do disable hyperthreading. That's another discussion. But on the longer term, the more wide messages here is that we are dealing with an entirely new class of attacks, which only became known since we had decades of fundamental side channel research. So I think that's also a good case to keep investing in fundamental research. And as a takeaway message, I would want to say that we should stop thinking about programs in terms of black boxes. Security is something that cross-cuts the entire stack, right? It enhances operating systems, virtual machines, compilers, down to the processor itself. So that's my main message today. Thanks.
Any questions on this?
All right. I'll first throw it to the...
You mentioned that we can expect CPUs with fixed meltdown in next year. Does that mean that they're going to be slower than the ones we have now? Like, my question is the fix for meltdown on the CPU level going to slow?
I see your question. It's a good question. First, a disclaimer. I can only hypothesize about that, right? But we don't have access to Intel's processor source code, but what I can say from my own experience with hardware design is that I strongly suspect that meltdown and foreshadow are caused by a very subtle hardware bug that probably only increases one CPU cycle. So I think this shows how crazy hardware designers have been over the past decades on making their processors just slightly faster. And what's actually happening is some kind of race condition, which depends on a single CPU cycle. So I think the patch for meltdown is probably ridiculously easy. It's just putting one little register in between so that it's clocked and that the next CPU cycle, instead of doing your access control and cache check in the same cycle, you put one cycle in between and you're good. So it's really a very subtle thing. And you also see this when you're trying to exploit it. When you're writing this exploit code, it really needs very specific circumstances in order to work. So it's definitely a very subtle vulnerability that I think will be rather straightforwardly fixed with low performance overhead.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so my question is, so you have mentioned Intel a lot, but what about AMD processors? So are they immune to this kind of attacks? And if that's the case, why?
Good question. So that's basically a question that has been repeating a lot in when talking about these kind of attacks. Mm-hmm. And the answer is also rather multifold. So at first, I want to make a clear division between Meltdown and Spectre. Spectre is an industry-wide issue. So Spectre equally affects Intel, AMD, ARM, virtually any processor, modern processor that has speculation. So Spectre, everyone agrees, is a very big and wide issue. Meltdown, a lot of people have said, is basically an Intel-specific bug, which goes to a certain length, yes. The problem is that, for instance, in this recent work that I showed, we show that at least certain meltdown effects can be reproduced on AMD. Mm-hmm. I also know that at least one version of the IBM Power processor is vulnerable for meltdown. There are a few rather exotic ARM processors which are vulnerable to meltdown. So what you see is with meltdown, the situation is less clear. With Spectre, it's the whole industry. With Meltdown, definitely the big hit was on Intel. But other processors are also vulnerable to more or lesser extent. And another side note here is that since Intel kind of has a monopoly in industry, we see also that most researchers are exclusively focusing on Intel. So you could say that Intel is over-researched, and I think us maybe researchers will move more towards AMD and also desirable towards RISC-V, for instance, we will see that I think more of these issues will pop up as well.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Any more questions?